did were not really of that nature for Geraldo. I did a piece about DNA and how it was going to be an interesting tool in the future, and had assistance in that piece from none other than Barry Scheck and Peter Newfield, who later became, very famous in the O.J. Simpson trial. So again, I did pieces like that, and ironically, I did another piece on something called Bigfoot. And that piece that I did on the Bigfoot piece, for Geraldo's Now It Can Be Told, actually helped me crack the Bigfoot case that we are seeing now in World's Greatest Hoaxes. The idea of serializing and trying to get the stories over a period of shows or a period of different opportunities, both in media, television, and print, has been sort of my credo. As a journalist, I'm trying to get to the bottom of the story.
All right, let me give you one story I've got by Michael Lewis on Bigfoot, all right? The legend of Bigfoot, the abominable snowman's North American cousin, said to stalk the densely forested Pacific Northwest, looks poised to take a hairy stride closer to reality. Researchers have computer-enhanced a much-derided 1967 film clip purportedly showing a female of these species and claim to have proved now that it chose a creature unknown to science, not a hoaxer in a fur suit. A forthcoming report by the Oregon-based North American Science Institute, whose three-year study cost about $100,000, will state that the film subject, a large, hairy, upright, walking figure with pendulous breasts, displays elasticity or the movement of skin over muscles. We have checked the film grain for inconsistency. This is a NASA research director, Todd Geary. If the fursuit was being used, we would expect to have located seams where the cloth folded. And he goes on and on and on. But they seem to be saying, we're moving toward validating this film, not the other way around. And this is from NASA.
I'm not impressed.
I understand you're not. So what do you have to suggest that it's a hoax?
I will say to you, Art, that if you look at this film,
I have,
in the details that we have in our show,
yes,
and you look at the original film that was released, like in the theaters in its early 70s, the film that actually got it to be known,
right,
and you check the provenance of that movie, the feature film, and you start looking into the people, like the informant in our show does, I think it's rather the preponderance of evidence right now on this case is not in the side of scientific validation. I cannot imagine any scientific group looking at a piece of film, and if we're talking about the video enhancements or the video transfers, if you will, that have floated around on most TV shows for the last 30 years, I think that it would be the old joke, garbage in and garbage out, because the resolution would not be sharp enough.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I like to think of, the thing I was going to give you a little bit of my career background.
Okay,
the idea of optically using pixels, per se,
yes,
to judge this film and validate it is absurd.
All right, well, then it should be equally absurd to judge it a hoax based on the same sort of pixelated
That's not what the show is about.
Okay.
Absolutely, a great point, and I agree with you 100%. Most juries would have to throw out photographic analysis on its own of an old film that no one really knows the actual. You will see in World's Greatest Hoaxes, Secrets Finally Revealed, the sharpest, most colorful resolution you have ever seen of this film. And since, let's say, you were in a theater in the early 70s when the movie was released by a company out of Salt Lake City.
How do you get that?
We were able to track down the original film in a vault that appeared in some movie theaters and had it cleaned and had it prepared as if it was going to be shown in a movie theater, and then we showed it to the public in the way we did. And we had the rights paid for through the proper channels. We paid for every possible right for this, and we're showing it to the public for the first time. Now, again, through the help of just using editing skills, we're able to combine some different takes, if you will, of the same imagery. Mm. There are people who've enhanced the images and posted them on the internet, and there are people that control those images, and we again got those rights as well. So we were able to get, like any good investigation team, legal or not, journalists or not, we were able to get all the evidence that is there picture-wise right now, photographic-wise, film and photo, and let it all be shown to the viewer as an informant for the first time steps forward, names names, says who he thinks is in the suit, says why he thinks this guy's in the suit. He says, quite frankly, because the guy told me he was in the suit. And when you see him compared to the imagery of the guy walking, whatever is walking in the Patterson film, to this individual today walking, it's rather eerie.
Okay, but you said a man who claims he was in the suit. I mean, isn't that like claims of the paranormal that are torn apart by the Joe Nichols of the Psychops of the world? I mean,
you know,
it's just
Joe,
another...
Joe Nichols and Psychop, the difference between us and, let's say, Skeptical Inquirer, who we do respect, and we, even when I'm doing a believing and a more how should I put it, friendly, believer-friendly piece for television, I would have to say that I find some flaw in the overall skeptical, almost negative stand of a Skeptical Inquirer. I am not that, and anyone who suggests that simply has not followed my work. The reality is the Bigfoot film has remained mysterious up until this broadcast. Finally, someone has stepped forward who worked at the film company who eventually marketed this film, and the obvious connections of could this company have somehow been behind the actual staging of the film should have been raised 30 years ago,
right,
by journalists.
Right, sure. The company that marketed the film, you've got to imagine, could have had some connection to it if it was a hoax.
But and by the way,
can you prove it?
Everything in our show that is exposed as a hoax is coming from an inside testimonial human being, like it would be at a, let's say, at a trial, at a any kind of that forum, okay?
Okay, but that's like Stephen Greer, who gathers of CSETI, who can gather together some of the best witnesses in the world in front of congressional committees.
Yeah, well, like who?
Oh, there's a whole, for example,
name
Corso.
Someone Stephen Greer has brought to the table of the UFO research community. And by the way, Art, you got to understand something. When you talk about the paranormal beat, you're talking to a guy who studies it.
Okay, sure. How about Colonel?
So let's talk about Steve. If you want to talk about Stephen Greer and CSETI, and you want to talk about credibility, and you want to compare a CSETI witness who may or may not talk to a congressional panel.
All right, but let's go back now to the Patterson film and Bigfoot. You've got somebody coming on the program who's going to say, I wore the suit, or somebody.
No, we have someone coming on the program saying, I know
a person
who hatched it. I know who's in the suit. I know he says it's a fraud, and he waited 30 years to tell his story because he said he just had gotten fed up with everybody saying this is such a mystery. When he says the guy who is in a suit is a person who was affiliated with the film company, and he told them several times personally, hey, it was me in the suit.
Okay, but
now,
still.
We talk to him. We have an interview with him,
right,
and he does deal with it. But you have to see the nature of the interview, Art, and so does the viewer, to really say, what about the denial? What about the denial of how he denies it? And why don't we look at the issue of means, opportunity, and motive, forgetting this one individual in the suit. Could the company literally have been that company, and what's the likelihood that they would have had the means and opportunity, and this guy was in the suit?
All right, even given means, opportunity, or even motive, you're still basing your conclusions on hearsay.
And what we'll be left with, we can bring Bob Gimlin, who is a witness to the event, which I've done more than once already, and then we didn't do it in this show because I think it's been pretty much done, and I think you only have one other person. Roger himself, unfortunately,
all right,
not with us.
We're going to pick up on that in a moment. We'll be right back. Bottom of the hour. This is Coast to Coast AM. 562-6438. All right. Robert is, in a moment, going to say something in a few moments, I guess, about the alien autopsy. And that one's going to blow you out of the water, or blow it out of the water. I'm pretty well convinced. But right now, we're talking about the Patterson Bigfoot film. And so far, Robert, it sounds good, but I mean, you've got to admit that it's not smoking gun type.
It's not.
Proof.
It's definitely not conclusive, and we make that point in the show.
Okay.
It is clearly provocative, to say the least, that he looks like the guy. I mean, I'm telling you that even if the individual named and outed here is not the Bigfoot guy in the Bigfoot suit,
is it?
It looks a lot like it's possible, and it's just maybe one of those incredible coincidences that he allegedly revealed to this individual, we'll call him Clyde for the moment, And by the way, you see his whole name. No one's in silhouette in the show. All right, everybody's out front and center. This would be no different than bringing somebody to trial, sticking a mimp in the stand and saying, tell us, sir, what you know about the Bigfoot film.
Well, do you actually confront the guy?
Absolutely.
No. I meant the guy who claims that he was in the suit.
Yes. He is interviewed in the show.
And he flat out says, I was in the suit.
No, he says he is not. He doesn't know exactly why he's been said or been pointed to.
Uh-huh.
He thinks it's because he's big. He sort of like fits the role. And also he had made another film with that same production company that made allegedly the Bigfoot hoax.
I see.
On the second hand, by the way, he's also very friendly with the executives from the company, being the former insurance salesman for the company.
A lot of synchronicity there.
So synchronicity for one, but I will say this. He's a very fair man. He gave an interview to the journalist, and I'll tell you, in our show, and so I will say this, that at least both sides are covered, but when he denies it, the viewer has to clearly watch carefully. The interview is stunning. It is something that I think, at the very least, there's some very, very compelling information in the show that has now been added to the Bigfoot mystery. And I'm not saying the Patterson film will never now be shown on television as a mystery. It probably still will. But I will say this, that it does now add, like I said, a very damaging thread potentially to the provenance of this film. And that is something that we have to start looking at provenance. That's what our show points out a lot, Art. That the provenance of films and UFO videos and things of the bizarre have to be looked at the same way that you look at, like, for instance, in an art situation, when you look at an art painting. What painting in the world is going to be deemed valid if you can't prove its provenance, if you don't know who the photographer was, if you don't know where the original is? And surely, if you don't have enough corroboratory information to even prove the people that say they were at a certain place at a certain time were the only there at the time. So it's really becoming very important, I think, as the year 2000 approaches, for believing people like me and all the other viewers and readers of any work I've ever done. I consider myself the advocate for the believer.
Did Cal Korf or Joe Nickel work with you on the production?
Cal Korf was a investigating additional investigator in the show.
Uh-huh.
Cal Korf definitely is interviewed in the program.
Oh, he is.
And Cal Korf is interviewed ostensibly, and I would say mostly for the Billy Meyer UFO segment. And I will clearly add, he has some interesting information about the Bigfoot film as well. The funny thing is, there are two other Bigfoot films presented in our show right after the Patterson film.
Is one of them a film taken from inside a vehicle?
No. One of them is known as the famous Yeti footage that started to appear around the world in 1996.
Mm.
Again, no known photographer, no known point of origin, no provenance, again, Art.
Mm.
And there's another one allegedly shot, I'm going to say roughly, in the Ohio area. We're not going to even get near. Can I prove it's Michigan? Can I prove it's Ohio? I don't know. The provenance on that film, it looks like a Bigfoot lost in the woods. It's very, very, it's interesting, in many ways sometimes even scary, and other times humorous. It's a very funny, interesting moment in terms of seeing how the Patterson film seems to have created a cottage industry, if you will, of Bigfoot videos and films. So again, it does indeed show us all, I think, that you have to be very careful when you see films as evidence of something scientific. We don't know if you could actually call this scientific evidence what we're revealing in our show on Bigfoot, but I will say this, forensically, it would be added to an evidentiary base, let's say at a trial, if you were trying to, like, let's say, and it's just a hypothetical, put the Patterson film's authenticity on the stand, and that may be coming an issue maybe down the road with the alien autopsy, I don't know, but there are people who feel right now that there are some parallels between things like the Patterson film and the alien autopsy.
Well, all right, what do you think about all of the sightings of Bigfoot before we leave that? I mean, there have been literally thousands of
around the world, right? I mean,
absolutely.
Talking about,
yes,
wild man in China.
Yes, in other words, the concept that time may have, in effect, left some sort of creature behind, that it may have survived through wily ways or whatever, and
absolutely,
that some earlier link, and it could still be alive in the world in various densely forested
absolutely
areas. So, in other words, you don't totally rule that out.
I don't at all. In fact, I think some of the natural assumption is going to be that, all right, so the logic is this, and I'll just take a step here and say, if the Patterson film constitutes the most evidence to date, the big piece of evidence to date, the smoking gun, if you will, that photographically, that such a creature might exist, and we put all our faith, a lot of faith in the Patterson film, I think that's a mistake, because I think the Patterson film came out literally of a wave of Bigfoot sightings and footprint recovery in the Northwest, Pacific Northwest, and Roger Patterson himself was a Bigfoot tracker.
Oh, yeah.
And, hey, he's tracking Bigfoot. Why not? If you have a film camera with you and a horse, maybe you'll be the one to capture Bigfoot. Well, why on film? Why not? I can buy that. On the other hand, it's also a little interesting that a guy who says, I'm tracking Bigfoot, I'm going to find Bigfoot, finds Bigfoot. Well, you know, hey, look, it's a great story. So we think we have added something very major to the Bigfoot in space, but by no means are we saying that the Bigfoot myth around the world, other places around the world that have their own Bigfoot legend
may not be so.
We have no way of knowing that.
All right.
And we're open to it, by the way.
Now, I am really surprised that you had Cal Korf. Cal Korf I've had on the air several times. And
why are you surprised?
Well, because Cal Korf reminds me of another Cal down in Southern California who sells cars, used cars. Cal is the opposite of a paranormal advocate.
Right.
He is, let's face it, Cal is a debunker.
Yes, I would say it's, by and large, there are cases that Cal believes. I'm not going to do the defending of Cal Korf. I think he could probably do his own, but I think in general he might be a little misunderstood. He also may be a little overzealous, and I think him and I have kind of chatted both in casual conversations and also some not-so-casual ones where really I say, Cal, you know, you cannot be just like all the other skeptics out there who just take a skeptical position just for skeptical sake.
Well, he does that a lot. I mean, right. he will admit, well, maybe this is true or that is true, but basically, and then he launches into a what can only be termed a total anti-paranormal mode.
But I will say this, there are very few people, in his defense, there are very few people, not that he needs any, by the way, but very few people who have the tenacity to at least stay on cases, travel to other countries, do his best to try to track down some information and talk to people, take names, you know, as it were, you know. And I'll tell you, we need a little more of that field investigation in the paranormal investigation
world. I agree.
So, I mean, how many people are there, Art? How many can we, you and I, in our different areas, you in radio and me in television and print, how can we chastise a guy who at least is making an attempt? Now, a little overzealous, I think, to be on the negative spin, I think, more than not. But there are cases that he and a few other skeptical journalists have touted as being possibly real, which I think is probably overlooked more than it should be.
Well, here's what I'll say. That overzealous, I think, is a good word, and Cal is all right. I've had him on the show. I've had him in debates. And he's an absolute wild man, and he does occasionally go too far. He did with me one time and had to end up apologizing over
absolutely
it. So, otherwise, but he's an all right guy. Now, why would you choose, of all people, to narrate something looking at hoaxes, trying to prove hoaxes, why would you choose Lance Henriksen, of all people, of Millennium, whose image...